All right, so next we're going to go through each individual song, each individual closing track, and we're going to discuss it as a group. So from the topping, no stopping.
From the topping, no stopping.
Working Man from the original debut Rush album. What are you guys' thoughts?
It's a really long song, 7 minutes, and with a 3.5 minute instrumental bridge. It's really good. I think that was probably an important track for them to show that, you know, they were an established group and they meant business, and so they couldn't leave on a soft tone. I think they came out and finished the album strong and set the tone for themselves.
Yeah, always a highlight live. That was amazing.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, I had it ranked like in the middle somewhere. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I just what they did with that nightly was amazing. Particularly the Time Machine tour. That DVD performance is off the hook.
Totally. Yeah, that's pretty crazy.
That's crazy.
I think that was the closing encore on that, wasn't it? On Time Machine? I think it was the last song. So yeah, last song on the album and last song on the Time Machine tour. Cool.
The last one on our 40 tour too. Well, besides that little bit of Garden Road, but
yeah.
Working Man definitely goes out with a bang.
Oh yeah.
I agree. So when I read my rankings, I had The Fountain of Lamb at last, and then Cygnus X1, Book One, The Voyage, and then Working Man. So I had three really long songs last, and I just wanted to explain my reasoning for that. Now, I had Natural Science fourth and La Villa third, and I'll get into that later. But these epics, I guess Working Man will consider it because it's long as an epic, or just because it's longer. But I feel like they're almost like it's almost too long at the end of the album. I feel like if you go through the whole album and then you're hit with a, you know, 10, 20 minute song at the end of the album, you're almost tired at that point, for lack of a better term. It's like you've already went through this whole album and then there's another really long song, and it's just harder to indulge than if the epic was at the beginning of the album, such as Hemispheres, Cygnus X1, Book 2, Hemispheres. So that's kind of just why, and I mean, I guess the original album didn't have songs as long as A Farewell to Kings or Crest of Steel, but I just put those three near the bottom just because they're longer. Anyways, anything else that anyone wants to say regarding Working Man?
I'm good.
Yeah.
Great. So next is In the End from Fly By Night.
I don't like that one. It's one of the few Rush songs that I just don't like. I don't know why I don't like it. I just don't.
It's called In the End, so like that in that it's a good ender, but
in the end we had this song.
right.
It would be weird if it wasn't at the end, so
that's true. They kind of had to.
I guess that's fair. Yeah, I mean, what else on Fly By Night would make a good ender, I guess, if In the End wasn't in the end. I mean, it's tough. I don't see anything else on there that would really wrap the album up.
And we have to keep in mind too that song was written before Neil really joined the band. Those aren't his lyrics, and so in one way, I think we have to be a little bit forgiving, you know, with Alex and Getty coming up with the lyrics on that, even though that was probably not their strongest
strongest suit in during that time period.
I like it. I like how it kind of comes in soft and then it, you know, gets heavier.
Mm-hmm. I feel the same way. I feel like it's a good, like, ending song.
Mm-hmm.
Kind of ends. I wouldn't say it's like a bang. It's not like particularly heavy, but it ends. It kind of wraps up the album, you know, nicely. Like there's like a sense of like finality to it. Like, okay, we concluded the album. So I like it. I put it in the middle.
Yeah, I think I did too.
Rankings.
All right, cool. So next is The Fountain of Lamneth. What are your guys' thoughts on that song as a closing track?
As a close?
I know that's one of Kate's favorite songs, and believe it or not, she had it right in the middle, or, yeah, right near the middle. I mean, it's, she had it, I'm sorry, 12th, so it's right in the middle, or near the middle. But, I mean, that just goes to show kind of the exercise here. So she loves that song, but she doesn't really see it as a fantastic closing track as a song like The Garden, which of course we all put first. I mean, Kate, do you want to touch on that?
Well, as we've discussed in previous episodes of their longest epics, The Fountain of Lamneth is the least, I think we keep saying cohesive, but it's true because I love it. It's like one of my favorite songs, but it just feels like a bunch of songs put together. Whereas Hemispheres and 2112, they go together, you know what I mean?
Sure.
I think it's, I mean, I can't really think of another song to end Caress of Steel other than maybe The Necromancer. But, I don't know, that's my piece. So.
Yeah, it's weird. It's such a long song that I don't think of it really like as a closing track. I mean, yeah, it is, but it's like the entire side too, you know? I don't know, it being long didn't bother me, but I think you're right, it is a little bit more disjointed and you know,
right,
it's kind of half-baked. they were really high when they wrote it, but it is half-baked in that it's, you know, it almost seemed like it was an experiment.
Yeah.
It's funny that you
see what we can do with this, and then went on with 2112, obviously. Go ahead.
It's funny that you said that, you know, they were pretty high during the recording of that. I remember hearing an interview from Geddy Lee, and he said that he thought the album, when they were all done with it, that this was going to be a very successful album.
Oh, they loved it, yeah.
Yeah, and turned out to be the complete opposite.
Yeah.
And so, but, you know, The Fountain, I think it's pretty good. It shows there's more creativity with them going kind of all over the place with the music, with all sorts of time signature changes and stuff, which later becomes, you know, something normal in their music.
That's the funnest part about their first few albums, that there's little bits and pieces. Oh, there they are, you know, and like you see the progression of where it was going. Yeah, so
Yep.
Awesome. Yeah, the only thing I was going to add was, if there was another song that I could see wrapping this album up, is just Lakeside Park.
Yeah.
I don't know. I don't really know why, but maybe just because it has meaning to Neil. But anyways, that being said, let's move on to 2112. So the last song on 2112 is Something for Nothing. Personally, so... you know, it's the second side, but I guess the last album, or excuse me, the last song on the album when you combine all the songs in today's day and age. So Something for Nothing, in my opinion, is, I'm not a huge fan of the song. Like, it's not in my, you know, top, probably not even in my top 50, maybe not even in my top 100 of Rush songs, if I could do such a thing. In terms of ranking, but I have it sixth on my list because I think it's I think it wraps up that album pretty well. I think it allows them to go out with a bang. And I think it's something that kind of, it's different. We mentioned slightly different. slightly different than the other songs on the album. It's not an epic like 2112. It's not a slower song like Lessons or like Tears. It's not really like a unique dark song like the Twilight Zone. So I think it's a perfect closing track for 2112. What do you guys think?
I love Something for Nothing. It's one of my favorite Rush songs, but I really love it as a closing track because in 2112, obviously it's a very long song, but it's got so much, you know, meaning. And then Something for Nothing, you're kind of ending with the song that also is pretty deep philosophical, especially in like, you know, the chorus. You know, you can't have something for nothing. You can't free it for free. It's pretty deep, I would think. So I like that.
Coming off of 2112 in a world where there isn't any freedom, you know.
Yeah, so it just wraps up absolutely perfectly, you know, and it is a heavier song, so I love it as a closing track. I put it as number 5 for me.
I have to say it's in my top 10. It's number 8 on this list, and Kira said, it has a powerful message, and I think in one way it kind of shows there was some uncertainty at that point in their career, because Alex had talked about, well, this was either going to make them or break them. He was contemplating about maybe just leaving, and maybe this was a, like, they were under a lot of pressure to get it right. Maybe it was pressure they put on themselves more than the record company.
Before we move on, Kira, do you have a picture of Kira right behind you that I just noticed?
Yeah.
Okay.
that's from high school. Those are my like senior yearbook photos. Yeah.
I assume you're at your parents, not...
I am at my parents.
Okay.
These were taken like right before I became a massive Rush fan, so you get to see what I looked like back then.
Anyways, I just thought that was funny. I just wanted to make sure that Kira wasn't hanging pictures of Kira in her own place.
No.
So let's move on to just immortalizing yourself. Farewell the King. So the last song on this album is Cygnus X1 Book 1, The Voyage. What are you guys' thoughts on that as a closing track?
It's kind of, in a way, I like it as a closing track, but it is more at the bottom of my list because it's transitional. Like, it it transitions beautifully from the end of Farewell to Kings to Hemispheres with the story, but as we mentioned earlier, it is kind of like a long song. So I like that it's transitional, but it's not the best in terms of like a closing track.
I think Chris said it. I think it might have been Chris or Rudy. I think it was Chris, but in terms of it, yeah, it is kind of a cliffhanger. I think when you look at both A Farewell to Kings and Hemispheres together, I think it makes total sense. But I think on its own as a closing track, that's another reason why I have it kind of, second to last on my list. I think it's a great song. I love to listen to it, but I just don't think it's, it doesn't really wrap the album up as a whole, in my opinion. It kind of lives on an island. It doesn't really have any kind of lasting impact in terms of wrapping the album up, in my opinion. I guess it goes out with a bang, but and I guess it's something you look forward to as it's an epic, but just doesn't do it for me as a closer. And again, I'm not sure what else you could put as a closer on this album. Maybe Closer to the Heart, but
that would have been really good.
Yeah.
But
Closer to the Heart.
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah, I personally wouldn't put Xanadu either, because that's also an epic, and that kind of goes against my point of having an epic closing the album out. But anybody else have anything to say about that? Cool. So just for the sake of time, just moving on here, Labilla Strangiato from Hemispheres. I put it third. Kira put it third. Kate put it third. So why did we put it third? Why do we like it so much? Ladies,
amazing. I mean, simple as that.
I put it second, so I like it even more than you do.
That's fair.
I think it's great. It doesn't bother me at all that it's long. I think it's, you know, Hemispheres is kind of a short album in terms of song. There's only four songs on it. It's just, oh my God. It's such a great little piece of craziness, and I just love it.
Yeah. In this case, I'm okay with it being last, you know, as a long song, only because it's such a short album. Well, short in terms of the number of songs, not in terms of time, but yeah, you have Cygnus X1 Book 2, you have Circumstances, you have The Trees, and you have La Villa Strangiato. So I don't think Circumstances or The Trees were really closing songs in this case. And I've always thought that La Villa was the type of song where Rush kind of just showed off, you know, their talent. And I think that definitely made them go out with a bang in terms of that album. And it's definitely a song that you look forward to, whether it be on the album, if you're listening to the album from top to bottom, or live, because I know they did La Villa live at Time Machine Tour. And I mean, I heard that, I saw it at SPAC in Saratoga, and I saw La Villa at Madison Square Garden. Perhaps, Chris, you said you lived in New York. Were you there too?
Oh, yeah, I was, yep.
But in terms of seeing it at SPAC, that was an outdoor venue in Saratoga, and I was blown away. That song specifically had some echo in the background throughout the outdoor venue, and it was just absolutely amazing. But
yeah, I saw Snakes and Arrows at that venue. It was a good play.
Okay. I was not there. I missed that one, but unfortunately. But that's when I was just getting into Rush, actually. So anybody else want to say anything about La Villa?
It's just such an atmospheric song. And for me, those make excellent closers, like Mystic Rhythms, which we'll get to that. But those kinds of songs, they make you feel a certain, you know, way. And I love that in a closer.
So. Let's add that to the list on the napkin. Atmospheric. Cool. So moving on, Permanent Waves, Natural Science is the closing track on that album. And someone had it really high up, I think. Chris.
I have
Chris
it had, three, yeah.
Yeah. I had it four, Kira had it four. And again, I think I think for me, because again, this is another short-ish album in terms of number of tracks, that's why I'm okay with it being a closer. Again, these songs are fairly longer, I guess, you know, with The Spirit of Radio and Free Will and Jacob's Ladder being all over 5 minutes. But I think just in terms of number of tracks, it functions as a closer. Mm-hmm. But Chris?
No, I was going to say, I have to admit, with my first few, I had a hard time distinguishing between, you know, what's my favorite song and what makes a great closing track. This is just one of my favorite songs. But I love it as a final track. Just the different segments of it. It's just been a favorite of mine since I was
to young. What we wrote down slightly different. And I think it's a little bit more than slightly different than the other songs on the album.
This is like a little mini epic, kind of.
Yes, you know? Exactly. Right. For sure.
I love the imagery that it has in it. Plus, it's definitely like, it's not just like an epic in its length, but it's like epic as in it's a natural, like, epic.
Oh, yeah.
Song. Such a killer way.
Right?
Yes. Such a killer way to wrap up. Permanent Waves, for sure, really does like capture your attention. At least it captured my attention when I first watched it live on the Rush Rio DVD.
Sure. So next is Vital Signs from Moving Pictures. I think someone mentioned this earlier. Slightly different. I think it was Rudy, right? Slightly different than the other songs on Moving Pictures.
Well, yeah, somewhat. I mean, you could hear the reggae influence in that, but you hear that on a different song on that album as well. But it's actually one of my least favorite closing songs. I think, you know, if you wanted to share someone a closing track, to me, this probably wouldn't be in the top 10. Okay. I don't know what it is. It's just I know it's Rush. It's just maybe I can't describe it. It's very different.
Maybe it was Chris that said that.
It was the reggae influence of it, and it just Getty said in an interview he was talking about. This would have been done sometime in the early 80s. He said the last line of Moving Pictures is everybody's got to deviate from the norm. And with the shift they made from Moving Pictures into Signals, they said that's kind of what we realized at that time is what had become the norm for Rush, is that there really wasn't a norm, you know, that it was all these different things. And the 80s is when they really started to put it all together. You know, from being a prog band into a more, you know, so Vital Signs, I think for me, I had it pretty high. I have a number of what, 5 or so, as being, you know, not just a great closing track, but a nice transition into where they were off to in the 80s.
Mm-hmm. So. I agree with Chris.
Yeah. Cool. Thank you.
Yeah. I mean, the only other thing that I want to say about Moving Pictures and closing tracks is I said in the opening tracks video that I thought Limelight could have functioned as an opening track. I know Tom Sawyer opened that album, but I feel like Limelight could have functioned as an opening track. I also feel that Limelight could have functioned as a closing track on this album too. Quite frankly, I think that could have fit anywhere, but anyway, so on to Signals, which is the closing track is Countdown. I know this is one that Kate really likes. You want to touch on that? And Pat as well.
Yep.
Both have it pretty high up. But I know Kate really likes this song in general.
Yeah, I love the song. And I think it's a great closer because my favorite part of the song is the end, like the fade out. It's just the music is so beautiful. Like, I wish it could go on forever.
Yeah, exactly.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Cool. Makes me, yeah, exactly. That feeling of wanting more of it.
Mm-hmm.
And now the whole album, it leaves you with like a... Like, you're satisfied, but you're, like, you're not really, you know what I mean? So,
yeah.
Songs that, like, on songs that, like, fade out, that, like, end, because, that, like, I don't know, it just, like, slowly goes away. It's, like, the album just, like, gradually just ends.
Mm-hmm.
Like, that aspect.
Mm-hmm.
All right.
Yeah, I like that one a lot.
Any songs, I mean, I know you guys all think it's a pretty good closer. Any songs you guys think might be a fair alternative from that album if they didn't choose Countdown?
Losing, it's a softer kind of song, but
what's that?
Losing, it's kind of more softer, somber.
The one that came to mind for me was The Weapon.
Yeah, maybe. That's a good one too.
All right. Moving on to Grace Under Pressure, Between the Wheels, the closer on that. Personally, I think it's pretty, pretty fantastic closer.
Chris likes it too.
I love this freaking song.
Go ahead. Do you want to talk about it?
Yeah. I mean, this has just been a favorite of mine forever. I think it was R30 when they pulled this out. I you know, my friend and I almost had a heart attack.
One they were pulling out of the vault.
Of the vault, absolutely. Yeah. I just always loved that song. You know, when I was a kid, I had a little synthesizer, a little tiny thing. And I, you know, set about learning every Rush song that I could. And I just loved those chords in the chorus. It was just really, you know, it had kind of an epic feel to it when I went in, and the way the guitar solo ends and the keyboards come back in and all that stuff. Oh, it's just amazing.
Anybody else Between the Wheels?
Sorry.
Cool. We're all in agreement. We like it. All right. next, Mystic Rhythms from Power Windows. Kate, myself, and Kira, again, we had the same top 3.
Mm-hmm.
We all put it second, so let's talk about it. I think personally for me, I think it's something that is slightly different than the other songs on Power Windows, but I think it's a perfect wrap up for that album.
Absolutely.
I've always kind of said that Power Windows is the most, for lack of a better term, average. Like, there's not like one song that really jumps out as something that's way better than everything else. So like all the songs are just like pretty good songs in my opinion. So I don't think it's an average album in terms of Rush by any means. I think it's really near the top, but I think it maybe has the most balance, I guess, is a better word.
Mm-hmm.
But I think Mystic Rhythms really wraps it up. It's pretty different. It leaves you, you know, a cool atmosphere, as Kate mentioned. Not necessarily goes out with a bang, but it is also something that you look forward to. You know, when mm-hmm. I listen to Power Windows, if I listen to it top to bottom, it's something that I really look forward to.
And it sets that tone right at the top with the drum beat. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Exactly. If that drum beat just lures you in, mm-hmm. and it's number two on my list on, and it okay. just, and then the mood that it conveys right after that drum intro, is just, I don't know, it stirs the soul, I think.
Mm-hmm, absolutely.
And you get what they're trying to say. Mm-hmm. So, and you know, you don't have to have a belief or anything, but I think you have some kind of an understanding with it.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Kate, you said in a prior video, Mystic Rhythms is like the perfect
night driving song.
Night driving song. Yep.
Like when you're out in the middle of nowhere.
Mm. Yeah. I totally agree. So next song is High Water from Hold Your Fire. What do you guys think? I know Rudy had mentioned High Water, right? I think it was.
Yeah, Rudy. that was number three on my list. So like Mystic Rhythms, the drums catch you in the beginning on that. And a little bit quicker pace. And there's something like, it stirs, I think, in my opinion, like the primitive, feel of it. Like, you know, we're all a part of, you know, there's water in us, there's water around us, there's water mm-hmm. in the air and, you know, in moisture form. So, it's pretty deep, I think.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I can't disagree with you. I think it's, I think it does have a humble message, as we mentioned, in terms of the napkin. So, yeah, I think it's, Hold Your Fire is not really, I think there's a lot of Rush fans that aren't huge fans of Hold Your Fire, but I think me personally, it's one of my favorites.
Mm-hmm.
I also just got a notification that this meeting will end in 10 minutes, so we got to.
Yeah, I got that.
Ooh. Okay. We may pause here for a second, but moving on to Presto. So, Available Light from Presto.
Mm-hmm.
I think Available Light's one of my favorite Rush songs. It's probably in my top 10 in general in my list of favorite Rush songs. And I think it's not, I don't think it's a great closer. I have it right in the middle, smack dab in the middle at 10. But I think it's one that definitely leaves you with a lasting impact. I think it's a very, again, to use the word atmospheric, pretty atmospheric song. Makes you feel some type of way, to quote Kate. what are your thoughts on Available Light?
It's a very poignant song. It's kind of more of like a ballad song, but like the guitar part is really, really beautiful, the drums. And I kind of like how they ended that album with a little bit of a more softer song, but also pretty rich as well. Very, like, very stirring and moving. Oh, it's right. A good one.
One of Getty's finest vocals, too.
Great. Yeah, yes, I agree.
You know,
it's a shame it was never done live.
Yeah. I was just going to ask if anyone heard them play it on tour.
No, we did it. I think it was the very first video we did of Rush Roundtable. It was songs that were never played live that we wish we saw live. and Available Light was one of my favorite, one of my songs on that, and my reasoning is because I always thought that Available Light was a song that if it became more popular, it was one that something or one that everyone in the arena could potentially have sung along to, kind of similar to like a Motley mm-hmm. Crue Home Sweet Home type of song, where like everyone kind of knows the lyrics to. I don't know. Obviously, the songs are totally different, but in terms of and the bands. But,
so did you just mention Rush and Motley Crue in the same?
I did. but in terms of that vibe that it gives you, like in terms of the audience singing along together, I always thought that it could have been that type of song. Everyone kind of singing in unison live, but it never materialized, I guess. As the band never played it live, unfortunately. But so, moving on to Roll the Bones. The last song on Roll the Bones is You Bet Your Life. Thoughts on You Bet Your Life?
I like this song a lot. This is one of those songs, and it's in the middle, I think, for me, but I think this is one of those songs that kind of summarizes the whole album. I sent Jerry from the Rush cast, that guy, I sent him a long email about this song. Because they didn't really like it, but I just love it, and I just think that it completely encompasses what the entire Roll the Bones album is about.
Sure.
That great lyrical riff in the choruses, no matter what religion you are, no matter what your philosophy on life is, no matter what music you listen to, no matter, you know, we're all in this shit together, and you know, stuff is gonna happen. Why?
Yeah.
Because it happens. So roll them bones.
It's a good point.
I thought about wearing my Roll the Bones shirt today, but I didn't.
shout out to Something for Nothing, the Rush fan cast, Jerry and
yes.
Steve. We had them on in a prior episode. They're good guys, and I really like listening to their podcast, but yeah, I agree. I agree, Chris. I'm a huge fan of You Bet Your Life, and I like your description of that. I honestly never really thought of it like that either, in terms of kind of wrapping the theme of the album up. I've actually kind of recently started really enjoying the song too. I never really got too much into it, but recently that and Face Up from Roll the Bones, I really started to love.
Fun part about that podcast is that it forces you to go back, and if you haven't listened to something in a while, so let me get this
for that. Sure. Yeah, we're going to be doing something similar as well, kind of just going through song by song for just kind of our opinions in a round table setting. So you guys mm-hmm. are more than welcome to come back on again if you guys want. But and anyone else who's watching the videos, feel free to shoot us a message and come on for those once we start to do those. So anything else you guys want to say on You Bet Your Life from Roll the Bones? Good. So on to Counterparts and Everyday Glory. What do you guys think about Everyday Glory as a closing track?
Love it.
Yeah.
Okay, that's a straight to the point.
It's another one of those kind of grand songs. Another fantastic Getty vocal.
Yep.
Great bridge at the end. I really like this one a lot.
Yeah, I have this up.
I like this whole album, but
Chris, likewise, Chris, you had it at 6. I had it at 5. Mm-hmm. I think I had it Pat had it at 2. Pat, why don't you talk about it?
I absolutely love it. Like, I love the song, but just to close Counterparts, which is such like a heavy album. And like the first like kind of like heavy serious album I had in a while, this one's kind of less heavy, like compared to like Stick It Out or Alien Tour. And I think it just the message it sends. And I remember we were talking about this before, like the last lyrics of the song before it just fades out. I think it is the best possible song that you could put besides The Garden, but the best possible song that could end an album. Mm.
So obviously this question isn't for you, Pat, but because you really like it as a closer. But any other songs you guys think perhaps could have closed this album if they didn't go with Everyday Glory, or do you think Everyday Glory was the right choice?
I think it's the perfect wrap-up. Yeah. It's not as heavy as the beginning of the album, but the lyrics in it are pretty, you know, relevant and pretty deep, especially with what's going on right now, and it kind of leaves you thinking. Definitely does leave an impact. It's a good song.
Fantastic. I'm just looking at the kitty.
Kate's a little distracted. So on to Test for Echo, and Carve Away the Stone is the closing track on Test for Echo. Personally, this doesn't do it for me. It's kind of become our motto on this this roundtable, on these videos, that all Rush is good. Some Rush is just better than other Rush. And in my opinion, I like Test for Echo. I like a good chunk of the songs, but Carve Away the Stone doesn't really do it for me. I think, if I was forced to pick another song that could have closed the album, something like The Color of Right, maybe. I do like the song The Color of Right, maybe half the world has a lasting impact, sends a humble message.
Yeah, right.
It's kind of atmospheric, but perhaps summarizes the album lyrically. But what are your guys' thoughts on Carve Away the Stone from Test for Echo, and is there any other songs perhaps that you think could fit as a closer on that album?
Yeah, I'm kind
this
of...
This towards the bottom of my list.
Yeah, mine too.
Now, I have to agree with you on, you know, Half the World would have been a good closer on that. But, you know, Carve Away the Stone is not high on the list either for me.
All right. So we're all in agreement it's pretty meh. So that being said, let's do a little go around the round table. Let's all pick a song that we would prefer to have close the album if it wasn't for Carve Away the Stone. So you already heard mine, Half the World. You already heard Rudy's, Half the World. So what about you, Kate?
I'm getting my trusty iPod. Yes, I still use an iPod.
Love it.
I think Half the World or The Color of Right.
Yep. So that's what I think. We're pretty, our lists kind of echo each other's, Kate. And our
I know.
Kira?
Half the World or The Color of Right, for sure, because of the lyrics and the lasting impact.
Copy paste.
I don't know if this is unpopular opinion. Maybe Time in Motion. I guess I just like the heaviness of it, but.
Yeah. Time in Motion is a song that Alex really likes, who's not with us today. Probably, maybe one that he would have chosen as an ending. I don't know. I don't want to speak to him, but I just know that he really loves that song. Pat?
I would say Resist.
Okay.
Oh, yeah, that is a good
Unique.
One.
Unique. Slightly different. Leaves a lasting impact. Mm-hmm. Look forward to it. Wraps it up. I mean, I guess it checks all the boxes. Yeah, that's a good. That's a fair point.
Yeah.
I was thinking the same thing, but... I don't know, that whole album has kind of faded in reflection for me. I liked it when it first came out, but it's it hasn't worn well for me.
That's fair,
my opinion. Yeah,
all right. So
might be a good one. Yeah,
yeah, I can certainly understand where you're coming from with that. So we're moving on to Vapor Trails and Out of the Cradle. As you guys know, I'm a pretty big fan of that song. Mm-hmm. I really like Out of the Cradle, but yeah, I mean, as a closer, I mean, I guess it's fine. It's not near the top of my list in terms of closing tracks.
I think it ticks the boxes in terms of wrapping up the album, I think. Just from what that entire album is about and that song, you know, you come out of the cradle, endlessly rocking. Because that's my fifth straight line. But yeah, I mean, I think for that purpose, I think it's probably the best choice as a closing track for that album.
All right.
I have high on my list too.
Yeah, you got a fourth. Do you want to speak to that?
Yeah, and like as a song, like as a song in general, it's not like one of my favorites, and you know that. But like to end the album, I think it's like for such like an album that's like just very like it's kind of like sad and you know realistic and just like you know kind of messy. This one kind of wraps it up nicely with like a little glimmer of hope. I like that a lot.
Just sitting here listening to you guys, you know, give your reasoning. I'm starting to think I probably should have put this a lot higher. And mainly for the, and I should have thought of this because it's literally my personal Instagram bio section, endlessly rocking, because I love that line. I guess that, you know, it's the end of the album and they're endlessly rocking. So I guess in that sense, it's a nice little wrap up, but yeah. Anybody else have anything they want to say about Out of the Cradle from Vapor Trails?
It's good, but I would have also liked Vapor Trail to close.
I was thinking that.
Ooh. Yeah, I would have liked that better too.
All right, so we're all just, the three of us are just in agreement on like everything.
Yeah.
I was thinking Secret Touch too, maybe, but a little heavier. All right, so moving on to feedback. Rush's cover album with Crossroads as the closer. I had mentioned that Crossroads, I could have saw opening the album too in the previous episode, but I'm fine with it closing the album too. I mean, I think we kind of all came to an agreement, the four of us on the last episode, that feedback, you could have arranged feedback in any order and it just wouldn't have much mattered because it's just a cover album. It's not really true Rush at its core. It's them paying homage to their, you know, their heroes. But I mean, anything, I don't want to spend too much time on feedback. Anything, any, you know, anything you guys want to say about Crossroads, you know, why you like it or don't like it?
I think they did it really well, but yeah, I mean, that's one that, I mean, I put it at the bottom just because it's not a Rush song. But
that's fair.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's fine. They did it really well live. In fact, why I heard that, because they did it a little bit faster than other people did.
Yeah.
Neil wanted to play it that way at the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. And Jan Wenner made them slow it down. He was apparently pretty pissed about that. I think they should have done it at what they wanted to do it. But that's, you know.
Yeah. Cool. Anybody else?
I put it towards the bottom, but not at like the very end, because I think it's a killer cover of the song and a killer closing song. I think that they did phenomenal. That one, but I wouldn't put it at the top because, you know, it's not true Rush, it's just a cover album, but I think that they nailed it regardless.
I said in the last album that I think Rush did Crossroads better than Clapton.
Oh.
No comment.
I guess I just love Rush, but I would prefer to listen to Rush's cover. All right, so before I get yelled at here, let's move on. Snakes and Arrows, We Hold On. What are your guys' thoughts on We Hold On as a closing track?
I think it works. I think it fits. It sums up the whole album for me.
All right.
Yeah, I think it wraps up pretty well, too. The tone of some of the songs is kind of like somber in a way, like Faithless, but it kind of ends like in like positivity. Well, kind of ends in a positive, you know that we're still holding on and keeping going, but mm-hmm. Not my favorite closing track, but it's good.
Yep.
Anybody else?
I think it makes sense for Snakes and Arrows, and I think it makes sense as a closing track.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I think that The Way the Wind Blows would have been an interesting closing track too. I like We Hold On. That just popped into my head just now. So.
Sure. All right. On to the last. We saved the best for last. So The Garden from Clockwork Angels. excuse me. Every single one of us put The Garden first, including you, Rudy, correct? I don't have your list in front of me.
Yes, I have it as number one.
So every single one of us, all six of us, put The Garden first on our list as our most favorite closing track. It closed this album. It closed their career in the studio, and it closed didn't it close Clockwork Angels?
Yeah,
I believe
the tour.
I could be wrong on that. Well, before the encore, wasn't it? Maybe I'm wrong.
No, it was the last of the Clockwork Angels songs they played, but it wasn't.
Okay, fair.
But they a couple more songs with the strings after that.
Oh, you're right. They did like Red Sector A. They did Dreamline. Yeah, Dreamline. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
So it pretty much closed their career, in a way. So I think that song, not only closing the album but closing their career in the studio, I think it's just as powerful as it can be. I mean, I don't.
We all put it. Powerful lyrics.
Oh yeah.
We all put it first. I mean, let's all say something about it. So, whoever wants to go first.
It's such a powerful song that it really takes your breath away. Actually, when I saw them in concert in the Clockwork Angels tour, that was like the one song that I was just like really sobbing and just crying to, hugging my parents, who were all like swaying to it. But it's just such a powerful ending to their, you know, career. I don't think they could have ended on a higher note than The Garden. And live, it's just absolutely tear-jerking.
Yeah, there's a lot. Go ahead.
No, you go ahead.
Yeah, there is a lot of emotion to it. I think this morning I listened to it again, and I think it hits a little bit deeper now with Neil's passing.
Yep.
That it became even more emotional to me. So,
I second that.
And it just is a really good, like, song, you know, a great way to not only wrap it up, but it's like, it's almost like a farewell, you know, in so many words.
I think it was Neil saying, now I got to go tend to my garden. Thanks, guys. This has been great.
Right.
I'm done. You know?
Right.
Yeah. That was not a good choice of song to listen to the day that we found out Neil died. Because that song brings me to tears every time I hear it anyway. Yeah, I think it's one of the most beautiful songs I've ever heard, period. It's absolutely in my top five. I think that entire album is a masterpiece. And, you know, for them to have left us with that, you know, the first time I heard it, I immediately thought of an interview with Getty. And if I remember correctly, it's on the R30 DVD extras. And it was when they got like Songwriters of the Decade or something like that in Canada in the 90s. And, or for the 80s, I guess. And Getty said in that interview, he was talking about how his life and his career was ongoing and all that stuff. And he said, I think somewhere inside me is a great song that I haven't written. And in my opinion, that's the one. I mean, you know, there's any number of other ones we can mention, but I just think that's absolute slam dunk. And I already told my kids we're playing that at my funeral whenever I can. And not like in the background. It's going to be, we're going to stop. We're going to listen to this song, folks. You know?
Is that the same interview where Alex said, who else would they give it to for the songwriters?
It might have been, yeah.
Who else would they pick?
Yeah, so Pat and Kate, you guys want to speak to The Garden?
Yeah, I think it was like their parting gift to us. It's such a beautiful song. I agree with what all of you guys have said. They definitely went out with a bang, not as in like heavy, but powerful, meaningful.
Yep.
My husband and I actually played at our wedding. We had an all prog wedding, no traditional music, all prog, but it's just a beautiful song, and they left us in the best way possible, I feel.
Yep.
And Pat, before you go, I don't want to lose this thought. A lot of people reach out to us on our page and say, when I say a lot of people, I mean a lot of people, not only just private messaging, but comments and stuff. Yeah. Do you think, now this is before Neil's passing, but do you think Rush is ever going to tour again? Do you think Rush is ever going to write another album? And we're always honest. We always say, you know, probably not, but maybe. But in my heart, I'm thinking to myself, I don't really want another album because it ended on such a high note. I mean, Clockwork Angels was such a fantastic album, and The Garden was such a fantastic closing song to their career. It's like, I don't want another album. I'm perfectly satisfied. This is a perfect ending to their career.
100%, but, I agree.
Absolutely.
Yeah, so, Pat, I mean, you want to just give your thoughts on The Garden?
I mean, I don't think I can say it any more perfectly than you guys did. There is literally no other
song. You're in the dark.
Their whole discography with that song. There is no song on the album that could probably replace it to be the last song. Like we said in the last episode, since it is a concept album, like, it's just absolutely... And I know I say the word perfect a lot, but, like, this is the true perfect song, so...
Yeah, I'm sorry, go ahead.
No, go ahead.
No, I was just going to say that I just what you were saying, Ryan, is that I don't think that they thought that they were going to top it. I really don't. Mm-hmm. You know, in all the interviews you've seen with them since that album came out, and particularly Neil talking about how not just the album but the tour, it was the first time that he felt completely satisfied with all of that. You know, even before he got cancer, we probably thought, you know what, that's... he's done, you know, like, I don't think that they think that they're going to be able to top this, and it made knowing that it was going to be the last one, like, okay, you know, I was like, if this is what they left us with, I'm good, that's fine.
Right, exactly. And I think, wish them well right before it, I think, is a could also, not for this album, or not for their career, but also could function as a pretty good closing song for an album. And I think it's cool that it's right before it, because it's a nice little transition into The Garden. I think they kind of go hand in hand. But any last thoughts you guys have before we wrap up the video, just in general, not just on The Garden or Clever Angels, but just in general as closing tracks?
I think so.
All right, fantastic. So thanks very much for joining us, Chris and Rudy. You guys are always more than welcome to stop back. And thank you for watching episode 16. We look forward to recording episode 17 here in the future. And take care, everyone.
All right, bye.
Thank you.